kings now living, a song of thanksgiving to God the Creator. Our voices we raise, God's banners fly o'er us, Christ's light goes before us, a pillar of light shining forth in the night. Till all things now living, unite in thanksgiving to God in
Hollywood United Methodist Church. We are glad you have joined us for worship this day in person and online. Please stand as you're able for opening hymns.
Yeah.
to invite any children in the congregation to come on up on the steps before we head out to children's church today. We have our children's church, which will be happening in Grant Hall. We have our youth group, which will meet in the Grace Room following the announcements. And our Christmas pageant rehearsal and our children's choir rehearsal happen both after services. So lots and lots going on. So I have a question for you. I will ask the question. I'll give you my example, and then if anybody has one. But what is something that makes you sad? What is something that makes you sad? So, like, I've always been somebody that when I see someone else crying, especially if it's somebody that I care about or a random person on television, I start crying. I can't help it, or I feel like I'm gonna cry. I just see someone cry, and it makes me very sad. Or if I'm somewhere and I see a little kid alone, or that looks lost, oh my gosh, I can't do anything. I have to stop and try to help that lost child find their family. What is something that makes you all sad?
Sad music, like violin.
The violin, that's really good. Do you have something, George? Something that makes you sad? Okay. Something that makes you sad?
When you fall.
When you fall.
When you fall or you see someone else fall. Any other things that you see? Maybe somebody else happens to somebody else. Miss April, do you have one that makes something that makes you sad that when you see? Putting you on the spot, I know.
You know, I kind of cry and get a little sad in happy moments.
Oh, interesting.
You know, so sometimes in movies, when it's, yeah, I do happy tears.
Happy tears.
Yeah,
happy
sometimes
tears
it's like
good.
That sad, happy at the same time.
Absolutely. So we've been talking about having empathy and compassion in on Children's Church in the last several weeks. And today we're talking about putting that compassion, which is maybe a feeling of sadness or empathy or just feeling for someone else, putting that into action. And so what are some ways that you can think of that here at our church, we put compassion into action, things that we do to help someone else, to make someone else happy? There is an example on the steps, I think maybe right behind you, Miss April. What is Anna Lee holding? Yeah, that is one of our compassion bears. We give those bears to children that are in the hospital during the Christmas season. And so there's a whole bunch of bears outside, and we're asking everyone to take one home, dress them up, and bring them back, and then we will give them to children that are sick and hopefully recovering. That's one thing we do. We make blessing bags. Have any of you ever helped make blessing bags here at the church? Yeah, we've done that. We usually do that in the gym, and we put together things that we think folks, some of our friends who maybe are unhoused might need, or someone that's on the street. It's usually a toothbrush, a deodorant, a water bottle, things like that. So we're looking for lots of opportunities to put our compassion into action, and that's what we're talking about today in our children's church time, okay? So let's pray, and then we're not going to go right to children's church because we're going to be a part of something here. We're going to get to see the new folks that are joining our church, and you are going to know one of those people and recognize them, so that'll be really fun. So let's pray, and then we'll sit back down. Our compassionate God, we strive to follow you in the way that we navigate the world and the way that we treat other people. Sometimes it's very easy to be selfish, to only think about our own needs and what we want and what will make us happy. Would you continue by your Spirit to shape our hearts, make us people of empathy and love and compassion, and help us to know how to put that compassion into action and do things and not just feel things for others. Shape us and mold us always to be more like your Son, Jesus, and we thank you. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. All right, I'll invite you to go back to the seats, and we will welcome our new members.
So at this time, we'd like to invite all those who are being received into membership to come forward. You have to have been in the class.
So we'll get you next time, okay? Alrighty. All right, why don't we all take a few steps that way? So we get you in the middle.
Perfect.
All right. So I'm going to pass the mic down to Pastor Bridie, but I'm going to ask you all to introduce yourselves.
Hello, I'm A.C. Gardner.
I'm Kevin Weiler.
April Olt.
Mari Bolianitz.
Charles.
Welcome to all of you. We have some questions for you this morning.
Mm-hmm. And everyone is coming to us by profession of faith, with the exception of April, who's being transferred from Kings Avenue. And they haven't written me back yet. So, okay. The United Methodist Church in Ohio. So, Pastor Bridie.
So I have some questions for you, and if you agree, you simply say, I do. Okay? On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? According to the grace given to you, will you remain faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representatives in the world? Excellent.
And two more. The first is about reception into the church as a whole. As members of Christ's universal church, will you be loyal to Jesus Christ through the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, say, I will. And finally, as members of this congregation of Hollywood United Methodist Church, will you faithfully participate in our ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say, I will. Members of the household of God, I commend these people to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm their hope, and perfect them in love. And will you join me in welcoming our new class, our fall class? Will you pray with me? Gracious God, we ask that your Spirit be upon each of these new members that we have received this morning. May you give them the strength and the courage to follow you in every aspect of their lives, and may they always know that they can never be away from your love and your grace. We pray this in the name of Jesus our Christ. Amen. And now, as we're welcoming our new members, will you please stand and greet one another with the peace of Christ? May the peace of Christ be with you.
Congratulations.
It's okay. Friends, if you too are thinking about being a member of our church, Pastor Kathy offers a membership class pretty regularly. We'd love to hear from you about it. All are welcome. So we forgot to do it for the balcony. The peace of the Lord be with you, friends in the balcony, and all those watching online. We're so grateful for you. And peace be with you as well, all those who are gathered here. I invite you now to take a deep breath. Just take a deep breath. Let it out. And prepare yourself for the special moment set aside in our service for prayer and reflection, intimate conversation with God. We are grateful that you're here, and we are blessed to enter this time together with our choir.
Rise to meet in the air.
Let us pray. God, holy creator, we come to you raising our voice in thanksgiving, glad to be in your presence here and in this place, and in all places, at all times. You are walking with us, guiding us, and blessing us, and for this we offer our thanks. All we have comes from you. May we use it wisely, these gifts of mind, body, spirit, and beyond, to build your peace and to expand your realm of love. Be with those today and always who are in need of your healing. Pour your presence over them. Strengthen the weak places, the cracks in the foundation of our faith, the breaks in our heart and our spirit. Provide solace to those that have aching hearts, and be with those who mourn and who grieve. This morning we offer gratitude for Natalie, Cassie, Dave, and so many others on their birthday. We offer comfort to Ruth on her loss and are grateful to you for Dottie's powerful send-off. Please bring healing to Tom and to Ed, to Trisha's parents, and to the Blondells, and so many others in need of it. And this morning, we especially lift up our brother Rance to you on the loss of his mother. Wrap him firmly in your arms and strengthen him on this difficult part of the journey, and help us to be there for him as well, present and supportive, whatever he may need. We pray for your peace in the war-torn places. We ask, dear God, for you to do what we seem to not be able to do, to shelter all from the violence of man. God, bring the end of armed conflict. And we pray for peace in our own city too. And this morning especially, we lift up the leaders of the Hart School District, the teachers there and the students, where they have been confronted with hateful legislation. We have many more prayers on our hearts and minds, and we offer them up to you now in a moment of silent prayer. God, you know what is on our hearts and minds every day, even when we don't make the time or find the time to share it with you. We are grateful that you are always receiving us, always calling us to you, always ready to bring us into your embrace and into your work in the world. We thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who made it awesome to practice radical love, to challenge things that are broken, and to work towards the kingdom of peace. And we offer to you the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
All right. Good Sunday morning, church family. Thank you for being here on this beautiful fall summer's day. Just real quick before I get started, anybody see the sign out front as you were walking in? Our sermon today is called Save, but the sign says, Save Rev Kathy. So, Rev Kathy, if there's something you need to talk about later on, just let me know. Okay? Oh! I just stole her joke. I'm so sorry. I did not know this. We did not coordinate. I thought I was being all on my own. Okay. All right, let's check in real quick. Everybody get out those phones. Back to the regular scheduled broadcast. I'll stop doing comedy. All right. So if you can, just drop your name in there. Any prayer requests that you got, we get those every day, pray over them every day, every Monday. So please share those with us if you have the chance today. Today, right after church, well, starting at 12:15, so you got a little bit of time, we're going to have Rev Jefferson from the Harmony campus. He's going to be here with his sound bowls, and we're doing a sound bath meditation worship session in the chapel. So please join us. There'll be chairs set up, but if you brought a mat or a blanket, the floor is carpeted, and you can also lay on the floor. This week, I do a small group at Harmony, but this week we're actually joining Harmony's Dining with Harmony, so we're going out to eat at Hungry Crowd. So if you're interested in that, that's happening 6:30 on Wednesday over in the valley, actually Toluca Lake. So just talk to me after church. I'll let you know more information. And then youth group. Oh, we have youth group coming up to talk today about the Christmas shop that's happening, and we're excited about that. So here they are. Come on up. Yeah. There you go.
Hi, my name is Emily, and I'm part of the church's youth group. I'm a senior in high school.
Hi, my name is Bill. I'm also in youth group, and I'm also a senior in high school. We are here to tell you about our upcoming project that will help low-income families this Christmas season.
It's called the HUMC Christmas Shop. This is our second year hosting this event, and it was a big success last year. And we're hoping all of you will help make us another success this year.
In the Christmas Shop, the youth group sets up a toy store filled with new toys and gifts for kids ages 18 and under. Then, working with our pastors, local organizations, and social workers, we invite parents who could benefit from a free toy store where they can pick out gifts for their children at no cost.
This is where you come in. Between now and December 8th, we're collecting new toys and gifts for kids 18 and under. You can bring in the gifts any Sunday to church, or you can go on our Amazon wish list and simply purchase the toys and have them mailed directly to the church.
We are passing out flyers now with all the details and a QR code that will take you to our Amazon wish list. For those of you watching online, you can scan the QR code on the screen. The Amazon wish lists are just ideas, but feel free to pick out items you think kids of any age will like.
Lastly, if you know a family who could benefit from the Christmas shop, just let Mr. Kevin, Director of Children and Youth Ministries here at church. You can reach him at kevin@hollywoodumc.org. His contact info is also on the flyer.
Thank you for helping make the HUMC Christmas shop a blessing to our community.
Right. It's that time of the year. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about Christmas, because next Sunday we are decorating the sanctuary for Christmas. So if you have time and you can stay after church, please spend the hour with us. We're going to put up the big tree and all of the Christmas decorations, and then have lunch afterwards with each other. So that starts right after church. And then this is for your calendar. Let's mark it down for the 3rd of December. It's a big Sunday for us. It's World AIDS Sunday, but we are premiering our docu-short called Red Ribbons of Love. And we have a lot of special guests coming, including our new bishop and our district superintendent. So please, if you can, be in attendance, and we will have a reception as well after that day in the gym. Also, don't forget, it's our first compassion bear that was turned in. Don't forget to pick up your compassion bears and dress them up and then bring them back starting in December. We're going to collect those, put them up here all month, and then in January take them to kids that are in care at the 5P21 clinic at USC. All right. Today we are going to be in the gym afterwards. It's all decorated for Back to the Future, so feel free to go up there, get your coffee, your tea, and your cookies, and take some pictures or do whatever you'd like, but we'll do that in the gym today, not in the courtyard like usual. All that we do here is made possible through your prayers, your presence, your service, and your gifts. So as the ushers come forward and we put up a QR code for electronic giving, please give as you're able so we can continue to do work here in the heart of Hollywood. Thank you so much.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew, the parable of the talents. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the one talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things, and I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not gather seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master replied, You wicked and lazy slave! You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow, and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Holy wisdom, holy words, thanks be to God.
This morning, we continue our stewardship sermon series entitled Earn, Save, Give. Earn all you can, save all you can, give all you can are the 3 basic points of John Wesley's famous sermon entitled The Use of Money. Wesley noted in 1789 that the Methodists of his day were ignoring the third part of his sermon. In fact, Wesley argued that the primary reason for the ineffectiveness of the Methodist movement was their failure to give all they could. And Wesley came to the conclusion that if Methodists would give all they can, then all would have enough. Now, John Wesley wasn't against people having money, nor did he think that money was evil. What mattered most was what people did with their money. In Wesley's words, money is an excellent gift of God, answering the noblest ends. In the hands of his children, it is food for the hungry, drink for the thirsty, raiment for the naked. Wesley was an Anglican, or an Episcopalian in this country, priest, who over time believed that the church had become an institution removed from its mission. Rather than make disciples of Jesus Christ and care for the least and the lost, being a voice against injustice, the denomination had become too entrenched in society, in caring for its place among the power brokers and movers and shakers. Wesley decided not to create a separate denomination. That was never his intention, although it happened. But he wanted to create a movement within the Anglican Church, a movement that was so methodical in the ways the people prayed and studied the Bible and gathered for groups and went out and visited in the hospitals and in prisons, protested against slavery and child labor and poverty, that they did all those things so well that they earned the derisive nickname Methodist. And eventually they became a denomination that one day planted a church here in the heart of Hollywood. Last week we talked about the importance that Wesley placed on earning all you can to enable ministry to happen. Today our focus is in saving all you can in the formula that Wesley laid out in his sermon on the use of money. We are to earn all we can and save all we can so that we can give all we can. Now it's worth noting that the sermon series is called Earn, Save, Give without that predicate, all we can. And what Devin was talking about, at our staff meeting last Tuesday, Pastor Mark Stevenson offered his own commentary on me not using the other part of all you can and how punctuation can make this week's marquee able to be read instead of save, period, It's Save Reverend Kathy Cooper Ledesma. I guess if I really needed the bat signal to be put up, that's the way I would do it. But really, it really is not Save Kathy Cooper Ledesma. It's, I assure you, it's Wesley saying save all you can. And I went back and looked at my emails where I send to the facility staff to ask just to see what I wrote, and I put no period there. So this is totally on me. Now, if you just took the first 2 points, you might think that Wesley was a strong proponent of what's known as the prosperity gospel, which essentially says that it is God's desire for each of us to live the American dream, amassing more and more wealth for ourselves, because wealth is a sign of God's blessings, and God wants us to be rich, right? Let me be really clear. That is not my theology, nor was it that of Wesley. In fact, as a measure of striving toward holiness of heart and mind, Wesley lived far below his means. As an academic at Oxford, as a member of the clergy, it was expected that his lifestyle would reflect that of a learned man with status obligations to society. Wesley rejected that notion and believed his only obligation was to God and to God's people. Even though his income rose annually, and sometimes greatly due to his employment, he did not increase his annual expenditures. He limited them instead, and he saved his money so that he could give it away. In fact, one year when he was audited by the English equivalent of the IRS, Wesley responded, "I have 2 silver spoons at London and 2 at Bristol. This is all the plate," meaning silver plate, "I have at present, and I shall not buy any more while so many round me want bread." See, Wesley understood the connection between his wealth and the poverty of others. He also understood that true holiness, true contentment in Jesus Christ comes when we spend more time giving thanks for what we have and how we can care for others, instead of thinking what we might buy for ourselves. Wesley knew that if we started spending money on things we did not really need, we'd both be wasting money that could go to better use, and we would then want more. We would never be satisfied with just what we have, instead of waiting and seeing how we might get more of God in our lives. That's why he believed in saving all we can, not to dip into later for ourselves, but to have money to spend on good uses. But we all know that kind of holiness is difficult. In today's reading from the Gospel of Matthew, we need to be a little cautious in our understanding of what it means and how it's interpreted. It has been used as a prime illustration of the prosperity gospel that I spoke about earlier. It's been used as a parable of judgment in the afterlife for those who live this life in fear without trust and risk in God. I suppose I see it differently. The man in Matthew's parable wants peace and security. He's going on a trip and he needs his property tended. He brings together 3 servants. To one, he gives 5 talents, about 100 years' wages. To the next, he gives 2, about 40 years' wages. And to the last, he gives 1 talent, about 20 years' wages. And he tells them that he trusts them with his treasure. Now, the 2 who received multiple talents invested in stocks and bonds and cattle and real estate, and so when the boss comes back, they're able to give him 100% return on his investment. And he's thrilled. But the servant who only received 1 talent, because he was afraid of the boss, he didn't want to risk losing anything, so he dug a hole in the ground and he placed the talent there. When the boss came back, he gave him the entirety of his investment back, but because he had been afraid of risk, of losing that which was entrusted to him, he had chosen to do nothing. Now, over the years, this parable has been understood to be about our attitude and about how all that we have has been entrusted to us by God's people. If we see God as only to be feared, if we see God as the source of all judgment rather than all love, then understandably, we're going to be like the servant with 1 talent, hesitant to risk out in faith in any way by investing our time or talent or treasure to build the kingdom. Now, that's the historically accepted interpretation of this parable, one that I've preached on in the past. But this week I read a sermon by Barbara Brown Taylor that she gave at Duke Chapel a few years ago. In that she asks, when did we decide that the man going on a journey in the parable of the talents was God? I know Jesus told it as a parable of the kingdom, but how does that turn the little M master in the story into the capital M master of the world? Haven't there always been a lot of masters applying for God's job, and some of them have just been plain lousy? I mean, seriously. We're seriously supposed to believe that the first two servants in this parable are the praiseworthy ones, both in this world and the next, for making a wealthy man wealthier, for keeping an absentee landlord in business, for scoring 100% rate of return for him in exchange for their own piece of the pie. These are the guys who are doing it right, while the third one, the only one who buries the talent where it can't do any more harm, the only one who tells the truth about the master, not behind his back, but to his face, the only one who refuses to play the game any longer, even if it means being banished from his master's expensive joy, he's the one who's overcautious, and his cowardice has cost him the opportunity for meaningful existence? Of course the master threw the third servant out. He couldn't have someone in the household exposing the truth that he gathered where he hadn't put anything, that he harvested what he did not sow. Can you really imagine the God that we worship, the God of source of all love and grace, saying to us, show me the money or be thrown into eternal darkness? That's not the God that I worship, and it's not the one that you do either. So maybe there's another way yet to view this parable that is not lifting up the prosperity gospel. It's not a parable of personal investment and risk. Maybe, just maybe, this parable is really about calling out unjust economic systems. Maybe it's about inviting us to name unfair and usurious business practices that hurt and that harm the least among us. Maybe it's an invitation to speak truth to power so that the playing field gets leveled just a bit more. We've seen what can happen when we do speak up and out for justice. The Writers Guild of America and SAG-AFTRA spent months on the picket line, and praise God, those strikes are over. And they are over with just resolutions for the unions who wage them. Fast food workers will now have their own minimum wage as of next April, as now, unlike when some of us grew up and it was a part-time job, they're staffed likely by people of color who are raising a family on poverty-level wages. And we know that our own Pastor Bridie will continue to lead efforts for justice in the hospitality industry. Amen? No matter which version of this parable fits your understanding, except for the prosperity gospel one, that's off the table. Off the table. This is always true. When we live as people confident in the all-inclusive and never-changing love of God and Jesus Christ, think what our own investments of time and talent and treasure and love and faith can bring. Love and faith, you see, like money, it requires the taking of risk to grow. And risk requires relationships. And relationships require opening ourselves to new possibilities that God has planned for it. This final illustration is actually better served for next week, but you'll understand why I'm sharing it with you now. There is one among us, now from San Diego, but has been part of our community of faith here in Hollywood since the 90s, is Tom Carpenter and his husband, Art Andrade. Over the years, Tom has spoken truth to power in many ways. But tonight, Tom is the subject of an episode of The Turning Point, a documentary series on MSNBC that tackles the big issues of the era. Tonight's episode is entitled Serving in Secret. It focuses on the series of events leading to the overturn of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, and the ban on gay folks serving in the military. The story focuses on Tom's experiences as a closeted Marine pilot and his resulting advocacy work to change U.S. policy and law. The documentary looks broadly at LGBTQ discrimination within the military, the politicization of the subject matter, and folks like Tom who have been involved in the decades-long struggle for equality within the U.S. Armed Forces. It's on tonight at 7 o'clock our time here, and I hope you will watch it. And that is Tom from way before I knew him. But it portends to be a wonderful documentary. And it's one of our own who's being that witness to our faith. So family, I invite you this week to reflect on what it means to you to earn, to save, and as we approach Thanksgiving, to give, so that we can truly fulfill Wesley's maxim: if Methodists would give all they can, then all would have enough. Amen. Thank you to our music department and to John West. For last week and for this week and for this busy season that's before us. Remember, today we are having fellowship in the gym. If you have a camera phone, you can take your camera, take pictures of the Enchantment Under the Sea stage, which is actually where it was filmed almost 40 years ago. So be sure to go back and have some good fellowship with one another. Go now, knowing that God loves you, knowing that God is a source of all grace, and go forth to love and serve the Lord. Amen.